good evening and welcome to
church tonight. Visiting with us, a warm welcome to you. I'm going to read from Psalm 45. I'm going to be referencing it later on in the service during the sermon, so I want to read a section from the middle of that psalm. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of your kingdom is a scepter of righteousness. For you have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. Your robes are all fragrant with myrrh and aloes and cassia. From ivory palaces, stringed instruments make you glad. Daughters of kings are among your ladies of honor. At your right hand stands the queen in gold of Ophir. Let's pray together. Lord, as we come to you this evening, we're reminded, just as we've read these words, that you, from most ancient times, have been preparing your people for the coming and arrival of your Son, the Lord Jesus, to be our Savior, to come, as it were, from ivory palaces into this world of woe, and in order that he might gather and meet his bride, his church, his people. And we thank you, Lord, that as we're gathered here tonight, for most of us, we are part of that church, your people. And we pray, Lord, that this evening we would find our communion with our Lord Jesus deepened, our understanding of him and our love for him strengthened, and that in all things he would be given the praise and the glory. In his strong name we pray. Amen. Now we're going to confess our sin together as we stand. We'll use the prayer you find in your bulletin. Let's all pray. O God, forgive us for thinking less of you than we ought, for we think your truth too high, your will too hard, and your power too remote. But they are not.
We humbly ask that you resolve our confused minds with your word, redirect our divided wills with your law, restore our troubled consciences with your forgiveness, and revive our anxious hearts with your presence, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us.
Amen. And hear this, the gospel's assurance of pardon from 2 Corinthians 5. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come.
As is our practice for our evening reading of the scriptures, we begin with prayer, but let me encourage you to turn to the Song of Solomon, which is the series Dr. Goligher has been leading us through. You can find the reading on page 560. We'll be looking at chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. As the word of God, which is holy and precious and given to us, is to us a gift, we must in many ways pause and ask our God to help this word be real and alive to us as we hear it read and as we hear it proclaimed to us. So would you join me in prayer? Our good and gracious Father in heaven, we thank you again for this opportunity to come together as the body of Christ, to worship you, to end this, the Lord's Day, with thoughts of eternal things, with reminders that our God reigns. Our God gives us all that we need for life and godliness in this world. But you, our God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, have provided us what we need for eternal life. So even tonight, would you prepare us eternally? Would you remind us of the truth we have in Christ and his deep and everlasting love for us? And Father, as we read your word, may we not only hear it, but may we listen. May our hearts be tender. May your spirit work within us that we truly listen to the voice of Almighty God. And we have ears to hear. We ask you to do that even now, in Jesus' precious and strong name. Amen. Hear now the word of God from the Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. I am a rose of Sharon, a lily of the valleys. As a lily among brambles, so is my love among the young women. As an apple tree among the trees of the forest, so is my beloved among the young men. With great delight I sat in his shadow, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. Sustain me with raisins, refresh me with apples, for I am sick with love. His left hand is under my head, and his right hand embraces me. I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Our Father in heaven, we thank you indeed that you have given us the privilege of giving back to you because of what you've given to us. We want to give all that we have to you. And Father, even now, this tithes and offerings are a token of our desire to give to you, that you would multiply your gifts for your glory. So bless these offerings, use them for Jesus' sake, in whose name we pray. Amen. Maybe.
Well, do take your Bibles and turn to the Song of Solomon, chapter 2. And while you're looking that up, let me remind you of the spring conference with Amy Bird coming up, 2 weeks to go. You can register online, or you can register this evening in reception hall. Your decision. But if you do it tonight, it's done. And you don't have to worry about it anymore. I'm taking a list of names. Doesn't matter what age you are. All of us can go. I'm going. Join me. It's going to be great. Okay, let's look at this great passage here that we're looking at this evening. John Owen will be familiar to some of you. John Owen was one of the great English, it vexes me to have to tell you that he was English, but he one of the great English theologians. And his works, there are 16 volumes of the normal stuff, and then there's another 6 volumes of his commentary on Hebrews. Once you dive into that, if we were following him in his exposition of Hebrews, we would all be in glory by the time we finished. But so there's a lot of works there, his collected works. But his second volume of works is probably one of the most regularly, most frequently recommended to Christian people for reading, because it contains his classic study on the subject, communion with Christ. Now, that may not immediately get your attention or sound exciting to you, but in many ways, the subject of communion with Christ, that is, knowing that we are united to Christ, so we have union with him, we are in Christ because we're believers. Communion with Christ has to do with our day-to-day interaction with, fellowship with, relationship to the Lord Jesus Christ as the most significant person in the life of a believer. Now, the interesting thing is that in handling this subject, Owen uses the Song of Solomon, he uses this passage we're looking at this evening. But he says something more generally about the Song of Solomon. He says, this whole book, Song of Songs, this whole book is taken up with the description of the communion that is between the Lord Christ and his saints. It's taken up with the communion between the Lord Christ and his saints. And Owen's view of this book is the view held by most of the church for most of the church's existence, except perhaps for the last 150 years, when influenced by German higher criticism, there has been a new approach to the Song of Solomon. And one of the effects of that new approach is actually evident subtly in the version that we're reading tonight. And that is the placement of who the characters are that are taking place. Most of it is right, but there are very interesting places where it's not right. So understand that where you read he, she in your translation here, that's not part of the Bible. That's been added by the printers, by the people who published this version. But in these verses we look at this evening, I want to pause on two particular points this evening. They are thrilling. These things that we're going to look at this evening, I just want to give you my personal testimony of this week. I have had the most wonderful, the most amazingly real and fascinating and stimulating sense of communion with the Lord Jesus this week, preparing these talks. I mean, it's been Chloe and I, and Chloe's the dog, by the way, and I've been putting her down. She comes up beside me when I'm working, and I've had to push her away so that I could walk up and down, walk up in sheer bliss and excitement at some of the things that I've discovered in this passage tonight.
Okay, you can reserve your opinion of me. But in this, in these two, I want to look at two verses. I want to look at the first and the second verse of chapter 2. And in these two verses, we have two lessons. One, what Christ says of himself, and what Christ says of his church. So in these verses, but then we have, first of all, Christ speaking there in verse 1. I am a rose of Sharon, a lily of the valleys. Now, there's a question, and you can see that from the way this has been laid out here, as to who is speaking here. In this case, the grammar doesn't help us. Other times it does. If it's feminine, it's most likely her. If it's masculine, it's most likely him. So that helps us in those places. It doesn't help us in this verse here. And so where the grammar doesn't help us, it's normal to be guided by the context. Some take it, and Carol Wynn last Sunday night was tempted to do that because he read right on into this verse. Some take it as a continuation of what she is saying at the end of chapter 1. In other words, that it describes the conclusion of the church's response, where she's speaking about what she shares with her Lord in the life in which he has given to her. Now, the problem with that is that if you read it, there is a disjunction. It goes from describing their shared life to this statement she is making, if it's her, that she is making about herself. And one of the things we've already learned as we've been gone through this book is that this would be terribly out of character for the church at this point. Terribly out of character. One of the reasons why it's been shifted up from where it would normally be is that since modern scholars take this book as to be purely about A, marriage, or B, sex, then they've had to kind of rejig the way in which it's laid out in order to sustain their rather exotic and novel approach to the book. And so this first verse is tied on to the end of what she's saying, in which she confesses to being, in their language, like a weak and delicate flower. Now you can see why, and the moderns would want that there, wouldn't you? Because that's the kind of view of women that has been especially significant among Christians in the middle of the 20th century, that women are weak and delicate flowers. Well, that's not what it's saying, and it's not who's talking. The speaker claims to be the chief flower in the rich plain of Sharon, a claim that would have been out of character for the bride to make, because as we've gotten to know her, we have begun to see that she is taking her identity from him. Indeed, when we look at verse 2, it's easier to understand who is speaking in verse 2. He's not introduced unless he's introduced in verse 1. The I of verse 1 is the one who claims the bride by this possessive particle, my, in verse 2. And most of the church fathers and the reformers and the Puritans and commentators right up until the end of the 19th century regarded this as Christ speaking to his church. So the flow of it goes something like this. In verse 1, Christ draws attention to himself. In verse 2, he draws attention to his church. In verse 1, he likens himself to two flowers. In verse 2, he compares her to one of those flowers. Many have pointed out the similarities here between the way Christ introduces himself here and the way we are familiar to him introducing himself in the Gospels. I am the light of the world. I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the true vine. I am meek and lowly of heart. I am the fountain of living water. John Owen reminds us that Christ is often compared to the most eminent things in God's creation. He is the Son of Righteousness. He is the bright and morning star. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. and among the flowers of the field, he is preeminent. But I hear an objection. I haven't asked you to mouth them to, but I'm reading your mind. Isn't it wrong or arrogant for someone to praise themselves in this way? Isn't it true that self-praise is no recommendation, we say? And that is true when it comes to creatures. We're not allowed to kind of parade ourselves in this manner as creatures. It's better for other people to find out we're as lovely as we think we are, on their own, without our help. But there is a massive difference between us and the Creator, because any discoveries we make about Christ must come from Him. He must introduce Himself from His end. He must take the initiative. There's a big question in the Bible, the answer to which is no, and the question is, can you, by searching, find out God? And the answer is no. God must introduce Himself to us. He must make Himself known. So listen to Christ as He makes Himself known in these two statements. I am the rose of Sharon. Sharon is the key. Sharon was a very beautiful plain on the Mediterranean coast that was known throughout the ancient world for its natural beauty, its peaceableness, and its fruitfulness. And in the Bible, which is where we should look to find out the significance of Sharon, in the Bible, Sharon is used as a picture of heaven. Let me give you one example. Isaiah chapter 33. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It shall blossom abundantly. It shall blossom like the rose. It's the same word as is used here. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. So the word rose and the word Sharon are in that passage, which is a talking about heaven. In other words, when Jesus says, I am the rose of Sharon, He is saying that He is the preeminent flower, He is the preeminent one in heaven and in the new creation. And why does He tell us these things about Himself? It's so that we will go and look for Him. In this passage, in this book, it's so the church will go looking for Him. He is not boasting or exaggerating. Spurgeon asks the question whether it would be boasting for the sun to say, I am brighter than the firefly. Would that be boasting? That would be obvious. Of course, by saying these things, he seeks to elevate our thoughts from the mundane and the ordinary and help us to grasp who he is, who has done all these things, who has made all these things, the natural world. And he has an eye for detail. We typically don't notice more than a fragment of what there is all around us. We realize that when we go to an art gallery and we look at a Turner or a Constable, a landscape, and we see through the artist's eye what the artist has noticed, what we would never notice. It's an amazing thing of wonder to do that. God sees even more than the artist sees, since he made it all and maintains it all. Jesus said, you remember, the sparrow doesn't fall to the ground without your Father. And if there is mystery and majesty, beauty and dignity in nature, then there is in Christ everything that surpasses all of that. It's absolutely obvious that the one who made nature would look to nature for illustrations in order to communicate to us something of his significance and his importance and his beauty. He surpasses all that there is to be found in created reality. He is saying to us, I am the rose of Sharon. He himself is the dazzling beauty of heaven, surpassing angels and archangels and all the departed saints, beyond measure, beyond all telling. We began this evening by reading from Psalm 45. It's a messianic psalm. The Jews knew that before Jesus, and the Christians knew that after Jesus. And one of the things you learn when you read the 45th Psalm is this. You learn that much of the imagery of that psalm is in this song of Solomon. In it, Christ is hailed by the prophet. Verse 1 of that psalm describes the prophetic gift as God is giving him words, and in his heart, he's bubbling over with this message. He can hardly get it out because it's weighing on him. It's bubbling out of him as he wants to tell what God has been saying to him. And the very first things he has to say are these: "You are the most handsome of the sons of men. Grace is poured upon your lips. Therefore, God has blessed you forever." And these words are utilized by the Apostle Paul, and they're applied directly to Jesus, who is God over all, blessed forever. Those last words are words that John echoes. "No one has ever seen God, but the only God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known." He is the rose of Sharon. He is the brightest and best that heaven has to give. He is the fairest that heaven has. He is beautiful beyond all comparison. And if that gives you a funny feeling to say that, it's because you are not taking in the sheer wonder and glory and beauty that there is in our Savior. The rose of Sharon. "I am the lily of the valley." I'm going to tell you something else about Psalm 45. Psalm 45 has as its divinely given title, in other words, it's part of the Bible. It's not one of the things put in by printers. It's in the Bible. Here's how it's described. It's to the choir master, according to the lilies, a love song. Isn't that interesting? Are you seeing connections here? I am the lily of the valley. What's this song of Solomon called? It's called the Song of Songs. What is it? It's a love song. The same love song as you find in Psalm 45. It's the love song between the Messiah and the church. Psalm 45 turns out to be a love song about the marriage of the divine bridegroom. "O God, your God has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions." It's God being addressed by God. And here is the eternal Son of God in his role as God's anointed, God's Messiah, the mediator, coming to receive his bride, the church. The lily psalm is a love song. And it's a love song about the bridegroom of our hearts. It's a love song about the Lord Jesus who comes from heaven to seek and to save his bride. I am the lily of the valleys. Why does he choose this image? When he came down to earth, he referenced this and distinguished this image from Solomon, in case you thought this song was all about Solomon and one of his many multitudes of wives. In case you thought that, Jesus distinguishes this song from Solomon and this image from Solomon. And he says to the people of his day, "Consider the lily of the fields, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these." Only Jesus can take that image and use it of himself. I am the lily of the valley. God prepared a body for his son. The Holy Spirit created that body in Mary's womb using her DNA. That body was perfectly suited for his life of compassion and obedience. It was perfectly matched as his humanity was without sin. The whiteness of the lily is captured by the purity of his life, the purity of his obedience. So that what we can say about the Lord Jesus, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good report, was to be found in him. He is the lily of the valley. He's the lily of the valley. Where does he come? He comes down into the valley of the shadow of death. this valley of our human experience, this valley of our human condition, suffering and dying in this human way, here with us in the fears and tears and the losses and crosses and the weariness and the weakness of our human frame. He came down into the valley, wrapped his glory in our humanity. And he comes as the I am. He comes as the one who says, I am the lily of the valley. The word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. In the language of one of the earliest of the church fathers, Origen, it says this, he says this, the bridegroom became a lily in this hollow because the heavenly Father clothed him in a garment of flesh. Now, these two titles that he uses here, I want you to notice the rose of Sharon points us to heaven. He comes as the highest thing that heaven has. The lily of the valley points us to earth, his humanity. Here we have a confluence of his deity and humanity together. The rose of Sharon and the lily of the valley. He combines in himself all the perfections of both majesty in heaven and humanity on earth. In him, all the lines of beauty are focused. The believer will never tire of him. He is all in all. Everything else in this world will fade and fall, but not the rose and not this lily. I am, Jesus says. In the language of Yahweh, the language of God himself, I am the rose. I am the lily. C.H. Spurgeon puts it like this, he is now all that he ever was, and he will be in life and death and throughout all eternity to the soul that has known him, an infinite variety of everything that is delightful. Everything that's delightful. His self-designation takes us to heaven. That means you must have him if you will ever go to heaven. You must have him as your own. And it means that you daily need him if you're going to go to heaven. In all the pressures and necessities of life, and in death when it happens, you will need him. The rose of Sharon and the lily of the valleys. Now, secondly, look at what Christ says then to his church. As a lily among thorns, so is my love among the daughters of men. Now, let me say in passing, now there's a lot of debate among scholars as to which particular flowers. You'll notice in the footnote or underneath in your ESV, it's properly this or that or the other thing. That is immaterial. It's in the Bible. So we look in the Bible to find where the words and the names are used elsewhere and the designations that are given. That's what's really important. We must stick to scriptural usage. And in all of the usages, these two titles, these two names are used in the most excellent and beautiful of ways. So here is Christ then, having spoken to himself, now telling us about his church and what his church is to him. My love, he says, is a lily among thorns. He is describing what she is to him and where she is. What she is to him, she is his love. She is his love. The church is Jesus' love. Christ loved the church. She is the apple of his eye. The Lord of life and glory, the Prince of the kings of the earth, has from eternity placed his love on his church, on his people. As the Father has loved me, he says, so have I loved you. Every believer is called into the fellowship of God's church, the fellowship of his people, and every believer can say, the Son of God loved me and gave himself for me. And when we all get to heaven, What a day of rejoicing that will be, and we will raise our songs of praise all together to him who has loved us and washed us from our sins. By his own blood, to him be the glory. His love for his church. She is his love. It is a distinguishing love. He distinguishes from everybody else and everything else. And he says, she is my love. He distinguishes her from the young women that represent humanity at large. When he came in the flesh, Jesus would pray, I pray not for the world, but for those that you have given me out of the world. They are yours. You gave them to me. And for their sakes, I consecrate, sanctify myself. That is to go to the death of the cross. And although we can honestly say to people, the Savior's love is immense, it is free, and he loves everything that he has made, there is nonetheless a particular, distinguishing, special, targeted love. He loves his own who are in the world. That's why husbands are to love their wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. That is, gave himself to death for her, risked everything for her, sacrificed everything for her, gave up his own life for her. Husbands, that's the way you're to love your wives, as Christ loved the church and died for her. The church is loved above all, not because of any merit, but because he has chosen to love them. And the Lord Jesus then set his heart and love in us. And this love was hidden at first in his heart, but then was gloriously revealed in his incarnation when all the angels sang to celebrate his coming. And now the incarnate God has loved and lived and died and risen and unveiled his love and astonished the angels and the archangels in the process by virtue of his coming for our salvation. At Calvary, he made an open show. John notes, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And when he sends his ministers out into the world, they are to proclaim to the world his love for people. And that love is outstanding. The many waters cannot quench that love. Neither life nor death, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation can ever separate the church from the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is not ashamed to call his people his church, as they're called by him in Revelation, the bride, the Lamb's wife, the church. And she has his love. And she has his likeness. Look what he says. I am the lily of the valley. And then he says to her, as a lily among thorns is my love. He takes the image he applies to himself, and he applies it to her. She is what he names her to be. That's what happens, by the way. He is the lily. She is as a lily. He is the original. She is the likeness. He has the beauty and excellence. He projects that beauty and excellence onto his bride. He is love. She is lovely. He has named her lovely, beautiful. And he's done all of that by sheer grace. My dad used to sing a lot. And he used to sing a song, Not have I gotten, but what I've received. Grace has bestowed it since I have believed. Boasting excluded, pride I abase. I'm only a sinner saved by grace. Jesus projects onto sinners something of his loveliness. If the lily stands for purity, he projects that onto us, and we become saints. That's what we are, aren't we? Believers are saints. The church is composed of saints. Well, you say, I know a lot of Christians and they're not saints. Well, that's because they're not living saintly. But they are saints in Jesus' eyes. They've been set apart by him, for him. And his Holy Spirit has distinguished them from the world. And here's the other thing. This is amazing. The one who gave the beauty is the first one to see the beauty in his people. And to note it, and to say so. She is like a lily among thorns, my love. When Saul of Tarsus, arch persecutor of Christians, gets converted, and God goes to a man called Ananias, because he wants Ananias to go and do the follow-up. And Ananias is obviously nervous to go and do the follow-up because this other man, Saul, has been taking people to prison and death. And this is a little passing comment. The Lord tells Ananias where he'll find Saul. And he says about Saul, and behold, he prays. He prays. Saul has just been converted. He hasn't had any time to do anything good, bad, or indifferent as a Christian. But the Lord Jesus saw beauty in him before it had worked its way out into his life. And however conflicted, compromised, confused the church may be, he loves her and he names her. He names her. He gives her his beauty. So he speaks of what she is, and then he speaks of where she is. She is a lily among thorns. We can take this by way of comparison or contrast. By way of comparison, then he's saying that the church stands out from the surroundings. Here is a lily blooming among in a thorn patch. And he's saying, well, she's different from that, isn't she? She stands out from all of that. His bride is far more glorious than the world. There are movers and shakers in the world, and some of Jesus' people get to be movers and shakers too, but they become great not because they're movers and shakers. They become great because they are his own. There are not many mighty, not many of noble birth, not many who are something in the world's eyes, but yet who are counted favored by the Savior. And what this is saying then, if we take it by way of comparison, is that all the great things of the world and all the great people of the world are but thorns and brambles compared to Christ's church. They spread, they occupy space, but in the end, in the final judgment, when the angel of judgment comes, what's he going to do? He's going to gather all of those thorns and brambles up and throw them on the eternal fire. Or we could take it as a contrast. It's probably both. We take it as a contrast. Then he's saying that she finds herself infiltrated by false friends and surrounded by bitter enemies. She is a lily among thorns. Jesus said, I'm sending you out into the world. The world hates you because it hated me also. She is like him. She suffers with him. The tests, the trials, the taunts, the temptations that tear in at the church and at Jesus' people lacerate their spirit. These daughters represent other people, human beings, people who follow the things of this world, the powers that threaten human life, whose father is the inventor of evil, the father of lies, the God of this age, who rages against the people of God. She is a lily among thorns. Christ has called himself the lily of the valley. He has named her a lily by extension and by virtue of the Holy Spirit that has been placed within her. She is like him, a lily among thorns. And he is like her. He too was a lily among thorns. Thorns that were taken and woven into a crown that was forced upon his brow and pressed viciously into his head for our sake. Here's an intimation, you see, of their relationship to Christ. We cost Jesus dear. We cost him dear. And those who follow him will find themselves surrounded by thorns. The world is not a friend to the friends of God. The world is not home to the bride of Christ. Behold, I send you forth, Jesus says, as a sheep among wolves. And yet here she is, a lily among thorns. That's just the position we find ourselves in. So how can we be a lily among thorns? Can we bless and not curse? Can we love our neighbor and even our enemy and expect no love in return? Can we seek to please but not provoke, to charm but not harm? Can we, as a lily among thorns, bring counsel, comfort, consolation with all the tenderness and gentleness of the Lord Jesus to those we come across in our everyday lives? For after all, we're here only for a short time. We're here, a lily among thorns. There is in us a secret, a savor, a scent that speaks of a higher reality. We let the light shine in the people, and people glorify our Father in heaven because we live like Jesus. And if we're a lily among thorns, what a shame it would be if the church is just as selfish and quarrelsome and unkind as the world is. So we need to see ourselves as Jesus sees us, a lily among thorns. You know, lilies normally grow in clusters. And what a joy to belong to a cluster of lilies. I'm just looking out at a cluster of lilies this evening. But some lilies have to grow alone. The solitary lily shows forth the beauty and glory of the Lord Jesus, even in a very hostile environment. And to the solitary lilies, I would say to you this evening, bear well the burden and to temptation and testing. Remember well whose spirit indwells you. And let everyone see your loving kindness and tenderness, that they might associate you with Jesus, whether for good or bad, associate you with Jesus. And here's one last thought. It's Charles Haddon Spurgeon's thought. He can make a lily grow among thorns until the thorns grow into lilies. That's what evangelism is all about, isn't it? That's what our presence in the world is for. And ultimately, the end of the game is, the end of the story, is that the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose in Sharon, in glory, in heaven. Do people associate us with Jesus, not only in the words you say, not only in your deeds confessed, but in the most unconscious way is Christ expressed? Is it a beatific smile, a holy light upon your brow? Oh no, I felt his presence when you laughed just now. To me, 'twas not the truth you taught, to you so clear, to me still dim. But when you came, you brought a sense of him. And from your eyes, he beckons me. And from your heart, his love is shed till I lose sight of you and see the Christ instead. Father, we pray that you would please write your word on our hearts this evening. We adore the Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, our Savior. We wonder that he has taken us to be his love and to make us like him by setting us aside with his name upon us for his own glory. We pray that you would deepen, Lord. We pray that through this series, our experimental experience of Christ would deepen, until he fills our horizon with his beauty and grace and majesty and becomes even more real to us, we pray, in his strong name. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. May the Lord bless you through your earthly life and pilgrimage and bring you to everlasting joy. God be with you.